What if I could put him in front of you? The man that ruined your life. If I could guarantee that you'd get away with it, would you kill him?
When discussing editing for a narrative question, there are a number of things you need to remember. Firstly, you need to include a specific example. Don't be vague. Secondly, you need to explain yourself. Don't just acknowledge that editing is there. Explain why. Thirdly, and most importantly, use appropriate and specific media terminology relevant to editing. You actually can't get full marks for questions in the exam if you don't use relevant terminology. Oh, and as a final thing to remember, of course it's not a bad idea to answer the question too. So let's break these down briefly, and then we'll go into more depth a little later. Number one, include a specific example. It's very easy to be general and talk vaguely about the existence of editing in the films you've studied. Students can say things like, editing is used extensively throughout the film to portray the frenetic pace of the action sequences and conveys to the audience the fear that the characters are feeling during these sequences. It sounds like a nice sentence, but it's not really saying anything. It's very vague and reads like you can't really remember the film, so you're just talking around the issue to try and hide it. Assessors know. They're all knowing. All wise. Like monkey magic.
Oh, the demon said we didn't have to take any tests.
You ought to listen to what's going on.
So it's important to have around 2 to 3 examples from each film that you discuss in depth for every production and story element, not just editing, all of them.
What?
Number two, explain yourself. What I mean by this is that you need to validate why you're using the examples that you are. Students are often really good at recognising examples of editing in films, but when writing about it in their answers, will simply acknowledge its existence and fail to analyse its relevance and importance, or discuss intelligently what the editing shows the audience, or why it's been included by the director. At the end of a sentence you've written about editing, you should ask yourself the questions why and how. If your discussion of editing isn't answering these questions, then you haven't written enough.
Oh, come on!
Number three. Use appropriate media terminology. This is vital. You actually can't get full marks if you don't use relevant media terminology. My advice is to be constantly looking for places in your answers that you can squeeze in media terminology. Use as much as you can, consistently, throughout your entire answer. My general guide is that you should use a specific relevant piece of media terminology for every mark that the question is worth. We'll get to this in more depth shortly.
Woo! Okay.
Number four, answer the question. Might seem obvious, but students can often forget that they have a question to answer and will simply write down what they remember about their examples and go into great depth about their example. But if you're not applying these examples to the question you've been given and continually referencing the question and showing the assessor that you're still on track throughout your answer, then you may be costing yourself marks. And even though I didn't mention it earlier, I'm going to throw in a fifth one too, and that is number five, show restraint. You've studied your narrative films extensively throughout the year. You've watched them many times, written many practice responses, you'll know them inside out. This means that you'll have a great deal you can write about them. If you get an editing question though, and you know 7 really good examples of editing from your film, you can't write about them all. It'll be tempting to show the assessor how awesome you are by showing them how many things you know.
She's giving her this big ridiculous intro, like she's done this, she's done that, she's done this, and she does the most difficult job on the planet.
What you're doing here, though, is depriving yourself of the chance to add depth to your answers. If you have an 8-mark question where you have to discuss both films and you use 7 different examples for one film, you're not going to have the time and space to go into detail analysing any of those examples. You may be thinking that it'll be impressive to write about all the different examples, but all of those examples will be basic and superficial and will actually weaken your response.
Good call!
With high-scoring responses, what you leave out and don't write about is just as important as what you put in. Show restraint. Choose 2, maybe 3, really good examples and just go into depth on those. You're actually going to weaken your response if you write about more than that. It'll be hard, but there'll be things that you know heaps about that you're just going to have to abandon and not write about in the exam.
It's not going to be easy. It's going to be really hard.
So let's apply all this to a question using the films we've studied this year. Here's the question. Describe a specific example of editing from both of the texts you studied this year. And this question is worth 6 marks. Firstly, let's gather our resources. We're going to combine number 1 and number 3 for this part. Choosing really good examples and thinking about the terminology we could use when writing about them. Let's first have a look at the terminology we could use for an editing response. We're clearly not going to use all of these, but good ones to use that are relevant to predestination are flashback, temporal frequency, temporal order, non-linear, and of course cut. I'm going to assume you know what flashback and cut mean, so I won't explain those. If you don't know what they mean,
get out.
So let's look at temporal order and temporal frequency. Remember that temporal is just a cool way of saying time. So when you discuss the temporal order of something, you're discussing the order of when in time events happen. So it's a really good term and example that enables you to string a whole heap of editing terms together. For example, predestination has flashback sequences, such as when John is telling the barkeep about the man who ruined his life when John was still Jane. This flashback means that the structuring of time, the temporal order, of the narrative is non-linear, meaning it's not told in a straight chronological line. So just like that, in one very small explanation and example, you're able to include four relevant pieces of media terminology. Let's look at the example we're going to be discussing, and then we'll look at how to put all these terms together.
I'm so sorry.
There he was.
Are you lost?
He told me he was waiting for someone.
Well, you know what they say about good things happening to those who wait.
But only the things left behind by those who hustle, he said. I couldn't believe it. It was a quote by Abraham Lincoln, and I was thinking the exact same thing.
What are the odds?
So whilst obviously the following wouldn't be your whole answer, this is how you might introduce it, using as much terminology as possible. In Predestination, John is relaying to the barkeep the story of the man who ruined his life, when he was still Jane. As John begins his story, the film cuts to a flashback sequence of Jane's first meeting with the man. This flashback disrupts the temporal order of the film and introduces the audience to the non-linear structure of the narrative that will be central to the film's time-travelling plot and circular narrative progression. So that's not a bad start, eh? Thanks very much. Nice of you to say. What's also useful about this example is the fact that it provides context for the assessor without spending too much time recounting plot details, something you want to avoid doing. You probably need to assume that the assessor hasn't seen the film you're discussing, but it's not your job to fill them in on what the film's about and outlining everything that happens in a scene you're discussing. You provide brief, concise detail to give context and then get to answering the question. You want to provide enough detail so that it's not confusing for the assessor, but not so much that you're spending a large portion of your answer simply retelling your film's plot. All I've included in the above example is that John is telling the barkeeper's story about the man who ruined his life, and also pointed out the important plot point that John used to be a woman named Jane. Any further plot detail beyond that is unnecessary and will take up too many words and too much time, thus robbing you of the chance to answer the question in depth. So be concise. Provide context, and then get to the point.
All right.
So let's look at our next bit of terminology we can include, temporal frequency. In short, temporal frequency is when an event in a narrative is returned to a number of times. Remembering that temporal means time and frequency means how often something occurs. What the term temporal frequency means in a narrative is how often we're returning to an event or a moment in time. So again, the previous example from Predestination is a good one, as the moment when Jane meets the man who ruined her life is visited more than once during the film. Temporal frequency is often effective in a film when each subsequent time the audience sees a particular event or scene, more information is revealed. In the previous clip from Predestination, John is recounting meeting the man who ruined his life before he had transitioned from being Jane to John. Throughout that sequence, whenever the man spoke, the audience doesn't hear his voice. John's voice narrating the story is used instead. It is also edited so as to obscure the mystery man's identity from the audience. The second time the audience frequents this event, however, a great deal more is revealed.
Dad.
so sorry. Are you lost?
No, I'm looking for someone. Thanks. I'll just wait.
Well, you know what they say about good things happening to those who wait.
But only the things left behind by those who hustle.
I was thinking the exact same thing. What are the odds?
Where are the odds?
Are you okay?
You're not how I imagined you'd look.
Do I know you?
So the first version of this clip we looked at, and the second one we just looked at now, is a really great editing example. It gives you a lot to discuss and analyze, and it allows you to include the terminology flashbacks, temporal frequency, temporal order, nonlinear, and of course cut. That's heaps to be able to talk about. So we've got 1 and 3 down. We also need to remember 2 and 4. Like I said earlier, simply acknowledging an editing example isn't enough. You need to analyze and explain its relevance, and of course make sure you're answering the question. Now in this instance, the question is just asking you to describe one example of editing. It's not asking you for deep analysis, but it's a good idea to be able to write that content in case you get a question that does ask you to analyze or discuss an example of editing. You can also weave in the temporal frequency part of the question by simply referring to the first example we looked at and then referencing that it does appear later on in the film. You're still technically only referring to one example, but referencing that it occurs more than once. At this point, you do have enough to write a response to the first half of this question, meaning you can write about one of the two films you have to write about. I'll put a full response in the description section beneath this clip, but the relevance of the editing in this clip could be, by utilizing temporal frequency and returning to events multiple times, the editing acts as a metaphor for the plot structure itself. There are multiple references to the concept of an Ouroboros in the film, the snake that eats its own tail.
She endures so much pain because of what I do. That's the way it has to be. It's the way it's always been. You should understand that better than anyone. A snake that eats its own tail forever and ever.
The grandfather paradox. I'm my own grandpa.
Cherry, I'm going on a break.
I'm my own grandpa.
Here we go.
Gotta go.
Which came first, the chicken or the egg?
What comes first, the chicken or the egg?
The rooster.
Ah, shit. See? I'm terrible.
There is the revelation at the end of Predestination that not only the plot, but the lives of the characters themselves is circular. That they are doomed to repeat and revisit the same moments in time over and over again, with no real beginning and no real end.
That's the way it has to be. It's the way it's always been.
The use of temporal order and temporal frequency in the previously mentioned examples is a metaphorical representation of the film's time-travelling plot. And like the film itself, the characters' lives are non-linear and will satisfy audiences who are fans of the science fiction time-travelling genre. Right.
So is that it? Story's over?
Yeah, afraid so.